Ready for reporting? One of the keys to manageable performance solutions with large data is good model design. Welcome, detectives. My name is Jason Richards, Microsoft Technical Trainer and Data Detective. Let's unravel the mysteries of model scalability, why it's important, and what tools exist in Fabric to help you and your team accomplish your goals. Gear up and let's get started. Before we talk through scalability, let's define what we're talking about. You'll notice that we refer to enterprise scale or large scale data rather than big data. Enterprise scale data is data that's massive, complex, diverse, rapid, and valuable. It requires a unified data platform that can handle all the aspects of data analytics from data movement to data science in a scalable and cost-effective way. Microsoft Fabric is such a platform, which offers a lake-centric data warehouse, a serverless data integration service, and a comprehensive suite of data engineering and data science tools. If you're familiar with working with enterprise data, it may be helpful to understand that the Power BI experience in Fabric is the next generation of analysis services. It's the same technology under the hood of analysis services and Power BI semantic models and the VertiPack engine. Scalability in this context refers to building data models that can handle growth in the volume of data. A data model that ingests thousands of rows of data may grow to millions of rows over time, and the model must be designed to accommodate such growth. It's important to consider that your data will grow and/or change, which increases complexity. Scalability must be at the forefront in enterprise solutions to ensure flexibility for changes, increases in data, and to reduce complexity. The best approach to building scalable data models will always be building with data modeling best practices in mind. Beyond the data model, Microsoft Fabric was designed specifically for enterprise deployments. Premium or Fabric capacity offers greater storage capacity and allows for larger individual semantic models depending on the stock keeping unit or SKU. Implementing the Fabric only large semantic model storage feature on a premium Fabric capacity enables data to grow beyond the Power BI desktop file size limitations or model size on this chart. Another important consideration in designing for scalability using Fabric is choosing the right capacity. You'll need to work with your Fabric administrator to determine which licensing SKU is available to you. If you're having performance issues, work first to optimize your model, and then work with your Fabric administrator to monitor Fabric capacities. At the most basic level, it's important to understand that premium capacities require sufficient memory for processing. You'll need to double the amount of RAM to process your data model refresh. For example, if you have a 40 gigabyte semantic model, you'll need at least 80 gigabytes of memory available. A 40 gigabyte semantic model would be best supported by an F256 capacity, which contains 100 gigabytes of memory. Implementing data modeling best practices is key to performant, scalable data models. Now, if you've worked with Power BI for reporting up to this point, you may be familiar with the storage modes you can implement when connecting to data sources. These are import, direct query, and dual. Import mode offers you the most options, design flexibility, and delivers fast performance. Use direct query when your data source stores large volumes of data and/or your report needs to deliver near real-time data. Finally, use dual mode when you need to boost the query performance of a direct query model, deliver near real-time query results from an import model, and extend a semantic model for an Azure Analysis Services model with other data. Dual storage combines data from more than one direct query source or combined direct query with import data. But we're here to talk about generating reports from Fabric. I mean, after all, we spent all this time setting up a lakehouse and warehouse so we can quickly generate a report, right? This is why we're going to talk a little bit more in depth about direct lake mode, which is an option as a storage mode in Power BI for connecting to guests. Yes, Fabric lakehouses and warehouses. Direct lake mode is a groundbreaking semantic model capability for analyzing very large data volumes. Direct lake is based on loading Parquet formatted files directly from a data lake without having to query a lakehouse or warehouse endpoint, and without having to import or duplicate data into a semantic model. Direct lake is a fast path to load the data from the lake straight into the Power BI engine, which is ready for analysis. The following diagram shows how classic import and direct query modes compare with direct lake mode. In direct query mode, the Power BI engine queries the data at the source, which can be slow, but avoids having to copy the data like with import mode. Any changes at the data source are immediately affected and reflected in the query results. On the other hand, with import mode, performance can be better because the data is cached and optimized for DAX and MDX report queries without having to translate and pass SQL or other types of queries to the data source. However, the Power BI engine must first copy any new data into the model during refresh. Any changes at the source are only picked up with the next model refresh. Direct lake mode eliminates the import requirement by loading the data directly from one lake. Unlike direct query, there's no translation from DAX or MDX to other query languages or query execution on other database systems, yielding performance like import mode. Because there's no explicit import process, it's possible to pick up any changes at the data source as they occur, combining the advantages of both direct query and import modes while avoiding their disadvantages. Direct lake mode can be the ideal choice for analyzing very large models and models with frequent updates at the data source, but depending on the use case, delta tables can be used in direct query or import using the lakehouse SQL endpoint. Direct lake also supports row level security and object level security, so users only see the data they have permissions to see. Up to this point, we've done a pretty considerable job of executing best practices when creating our lakehouse and warehouse assets, but anytime data is going to be associated to a semantic model, you want to do as much data preparation work as possible before data reaches Power BI, as far upstream as possible. For example, if you can transform data in the data warehouse, that's where it should be done. Transformation at the source produces consistency for any other solutions built on that data and ensures that your semantic model doesn't need to do any extra processing. This may require working with your data engineer or other members of your data team and is critically important. Feel free to jot down these best practices or cache them in your internal database. Semantic models store data in a highly compressed in-memory cache for optimized query performance. Enterprise deployment of an analytics solution will likely require a premium per user license for Power BI or a premium capacity. With the large semantic model storage format enabled, sizes are limited only by the capacity size or a maximum size set by the administrator. This differs from semantic models in Power BI Premium, which are limited to 10 gigabytes after compression if large semantic model storage format isn't enabled. Large semantic models can be enabled for all premium P SKUs, embedded A SKUs, and with premium per user and fabric capacities. Enabling the large semantic model format enables fast user interactivity and allows data to grow beyond the 10 gigabyte limit. Additionally, the large semantic model format can also improve XMLA write operation performance, even for semantic models that may not be large. It should be noted that semantic models enabled for large models can't be downloaded as a Power BI desktop PBIX type file from the Power BI experience. To take advantage of the large semantic model storage format option, it must be enabled at the Power BI experience. Here, you can enable large semantic model storage format for a single semantic model or for all semantic models created in a workspace. To enable large semantic model storage format for a single semantic model in the semantic model settings, toggle the slider to on and select apply. You can also set the default storage format for all semantic models created in a workspace in the workspace settings. In the settings, select premium and select large semantic model storage format as the default storage format. Large semantic model storage format for a workspace can also be enabled using PowerShell. Guess what time it is? Yep, DetectoLab 5000 is raring to put knowledge to practice. Let's dive in.
All right, welcome back to the environment. This will be nice, short, and sweet. We're talking about large semantic models, right? So that's what I'm going to show you. That's really about the only thing I can demo on this topic is the large semantic model options. When we're dealing with enterprise-level data, you have to keep in mind that when we're developing models in Power BI and then publishing them to the service, there's size limitations on the model size, depending on the license that you have, pro, premium, or capacity licenses. And even with a premium per user license, there are still limits, like up to 10 gigabytes, I believe, for a model size to be published. Well, if we have more data imported on the model and we need to push this into the service, we're gonna need more capabilities, right? So those are options that we can enable in a couple different levels in our workspace or in our items within our workspace or the workspace itself. Let's look at the items because I want to really point out the differences between your default semantic model and any models that you create in the service itself. Now, whenever we create a lakehouse or a warehouse and we add tables to it, then it creates a semantic model for us. These are default semantic models. Now, if I go into my settings for this, into this particular, and I have all of them so I could show you, you can see that I have a few options, a few settings that I can change, like query caching, refresh, so on and so forth. Same thing with my warehouse, same options, except, let's see, there's one in here, I think request access is different, no. It looks like there's server settings, no. Oh, Q&A? Oh, featured Q&A. All right, so there's a little bit of difference between Q&A and featured Q&A questions. But I can't do anything with the semantic model size. So when we're working with our default semantic model, I think this is important to point out in this one, is that they're very limited in what we can do to work with. The default semantic model is more designed for us to just do some quick analytics on something. If I want to see some quick visuals, then I can do that by using my default semantic model without me having to create a new model, create all the relationships in between it, so on and so forth. But when you create a new model and then associate it with, you know, lakehouse or warehouse objects, you can see that I have more options here for settings, including a large semantic model format. So if I'm dealing, now it says right here that my semantic model size is 1 megabyte, but for most premium capacities, using the large semantic model storage format can improve performance. So I can turn that on. What I wanna test out is to see if I set this at the workplace level, if that's gonna trickle down into my individual custom models that I've created here. So let's go back to the workspace and I'll show you where we can do that. In workspace settings, this is where I can, under my premium option, I can enable large semantic models and then apply that. And this applies to all the workspace objects. Any new semantic models that I create should be automatically enabled in the large semantic model storage format from here out. What I don't know is if that changes any current models that you might have created that didn't have it before you enabled it at the workspace level. So we'll see if clear all these out. I don't know if that's going to create a notification to let me know if that has been enabled yet. Probably one other thing I'll point out in here is the Git integration, because I didn't cover it in a different demo and I apologize, but just know that under your workspace settings, this is where we can connect to either a DevOps account or a Git repository. right? So I already have a DevOps account associated with this, with my intro ID, but I can also connect to a Git repository and connect and sync that as well. Just keep in mind that things like data pipeline objects, notebooks, these are all coded, right? What you wouldn't know it by looking at a pipeline because it's a visual interface, but underlying those data pipelines, they create JSON code, declarative statements that can be saved in a Git repository. And then I can just make updates to the underlying code, which will therefore change the way that the data pipeline operates and use an infrastructure's code type of mechanism instead of, you know, going in and changing a data pipeline in this UI itself. I can go into the Git branch or my Azure DevOps account, change the objects there and push those or publish those changes into here, and they'll apply, make massive changes and apply them all at the same time if need be, without and doing it at a time when people aren't on here working on it. So Git integration is great for continuous integration, continuous delivery, because I can change things. I can push those changes out at a time when people aren't utilizing those services at that point. It's a great thing to do. What I want to see is if I go into, let's look at the settings under my semantic models again, just to see what happened here. I just want to see if my large semantic model applied to this. And you can see that it didn't. So it'd probably be a good idea to go ahead and set that at the workspace level before creating custom models, because now I can go ahead and turn this on and apply it for this. But it didn't apply that once I've already created a custom model. So if you need to make sure, especially if you have F64 capacity or higher, there's usually unlimited model size that you can publish at that point. You'll want to make sure that we have this large semantic model storage format. Just keep in mind that, you know, because of this, or set at the workspace level first before starting to create custom models. If you've already created custom models, you can always come back in and change that setting automatically for you, or change that setting within the actual semantic model itself. That pretty much covers it. Let's go back into the studio.
Awesome job, detectives. We just learned about the mysteries of model scalability, how to leverage Microsoft Fabric as a unified data platform for enterprise scale data analytics, and how to use direct lake mode and large semantic model storage format to build fast and flexible data models. Thanks for joining.